just sense that there's a will to get the thing back on track. You know, last season was not the way it normally plays out here in St. Louis. So there's a common will to get the thing back on track.
Well, we were highly motivated to do that. And I think Mo and his team did a good job of filling some holes that we had and you know, getting us in a position where we can be, you know, competitive for the in the division and you know, in the league. So I'm happy with what has been accomplished in the postseason here.
You know, Mo made a good point the other day when he spoke to us about when he brought in Chaim Bloom, it's to get a view from the outside to see where we are compared to industry. After last year and then the previous years with unfortunate playoff results, do you guys, from an ownership standpoint, also take a different perspective, try to get a different vantage point to make sure you got the thing as high, the level as high as possible?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because when I saw that Chaim had been let go in Boston and Mo saw it as well, I immediately thought, you know, we could probably use someone like that who's been with a small market, big market, very smart guy, to kind of help see what's going on with our organization. And, you know, interestingly, Mo thought the same thing. And so he called me like 2 days later and I said, you know, it's interesting because I had the same thought. And, you know, we're on the same page there, which is great. I think he can be very helpful. I mean, our team's been together a long time and, you know, you never know what else is out there that you know, maybe our guys, you know, have not, you know, been in touch with or, you know, the world changes and it's helpful to get the perspective for somebody who's, you know, been with different organizations.
Bill, you see the money that the Dodgers spent, not just on the top free agent available, and the money they deferred specifically for that top free agent, but also the extensions that Atlanta's spending, the money that the Mets threw around last year. As an owner, are you at all concerned that the gap is getting wider between the teams at that level of spending and teams in your spot or even teams lower, like in your division?
Well, I think it's, you know, the way the game is set up now, the big markets have an advantage in terms of revenue they generate, and, you know, they're taking advantage of that. So, you know, we're in a certain level of the market and try to do everything we can to compete with that and, of course, the other teams that we play. But, you know, it's kind of the nature of the game, and give them credit. I mean, if they have the resources to do that, which they do, you know, they're going to try to have the best teams possible, and, you know, same thing we're trying to do.
How do you close that gap? If it's not financial, then is it with innovation? Is it structure? Is it spending elsewhere in player development? And how do you do that at a time when also the RSN rights might just be in turmoil?
Well, on the RSN front, fortunately, it looks like we'll get full payment this year, which gives us a full year to try to figure out how we're going to best monetize our TV rights. I mean, we've got a big audience. As you know, Cardinal country is bigger than the city of St. Louis, and we think we can do pretty well in the future, but it's to be determined because we haven't really run that operation internally, and we'll see how that develops.
And then the other part of that is closing the gap. If you can't do it financially with the bigger market teams, where do you do it? Does it have to be on the player development or innovation front?
Well, I mean, you compete the best way you can, and we've always felt that draft and develop is the Cardinal model, and it's played out pretty well for us over the years. So, you know, we'll continue to do that, but pick our spots on free agents, and, you know, we feel like we can compete with anybody. You know, they clearly have an advantage, but, you know, I think we saw this last year where, you know, some of the higher priced payrolls didn't necessarily do that well. Baseball's an interesting game that way.
You mentioned draft and develop. Obviously, it's worked with a lot of hitters lately. It used to work really well with pitchers, but maybe not yet. I mean, obviously, Tinkens and all them haven't made it to the bigs yet, so acknowledging that. But what have you learned as leaders in regards to scouting, drafting, and developing players over the last recent years from a pitching standpoint?
I guess you'd have to ask, you know, Mo and the team that. You know, we've been performance-oriented, so pitchers who have performed well, we're more apt to draft than, you know, those who have maybe more physical tools, and there, maybe there's a balance there. You know, our goal is to obviously develop pitchers. That's where you know, our need has been. We've done well on the position player side, but not so much on pitching. Good news is that, you know, when we got in a position where we needed to make some changes, we got some really good pitching prospects. And, you know, the one who got the award last night, Bragesick, I think I pronounced that correctly, there's an example of a good young kid who's you know, really good prospect. So the more good prospects you have on the pitching front, the better. But, you know, as you saw, we went outside the organization to get the three pitchers we got. And, you know, we'll try to do a better job on drafting and developing. The uncertainty on
the future of Valley, not just for 2024, but beyond?
No, we were pretty committed this year to do what we've done, you know, the kind of payroll that we're going to have. We knew that we would get 80% at the worst, probably on the Valley front, but that's a big hit, losing 20%. And, you know, as time goes on, we'll know better what we can expect in the future. But right now, we don't really have that knowledge. So, you know, that'll impact our payroll.
Bill, I believe yesterday was the 8-year anniversary of the NFL vote that moved the Rams out of St. Louis. And Bill, you went out that night with Tom Stillman and made a pretty public statement, you know, in favor of the city and in sort of standing up for a city that lost the team. There was a vote this past fall where the A's were given unanimous consent from the ownership to move from Oakland to Las Vegas. Do you see conflict in that? And is that a circle you can square, or do you think those are two different situations?
Conflict in what sense?
You all were very strong about how you felt about the way that things happened with the Rams and the stability that St. Louis earned from supporting that team. There's a fan base in Oakland that is going to lose their team, presumably. Do you think that there is a conflict there in being a vote in favor of that move, or do you not see?
Well, I think Oakland tried forever to get a new stadium, and they just weren't able to do it. And frankly, I haven't been there for a long time, but I know, you know, it was not a good situation from a stadium standpoint. So, you know, they really needed one, and they couldn't pull it off. And so that really drove the move.
I think when you look at what happened here, I mean, we had a stadium plan teed up in St. Louis. So, look, there was a lawsuit that settled for a giant number, which suggests that those paying the damages on that lawsuit might have felt like perhaps they weren't as clear about the process as they could have been. I'll leave it at that. But they're totally different situations, I think.
Or how do you guys feel about
Well, we're very positive on Oli as our manager. And, you know, we'll see how this year goes, but I have full expectation that after this year, he'll continue as our manager.
How would you describe, do you have appetite, interest in making more additions to this team before games begin? There seems like there's still a lot of free agents on the pitching side, relievers, starters that, that could be beneficial that are maybe going to start to get hungry to have a deal in hand before too long.
I know Mo and his group are out there looking particularly at the reliever market. So it would be nice if we could acquire some additional help on that front.
When you look back at last season, what stood out to you most as the thing that you most want to see be addressed or fixed in this season? We've heard a lot of players, coaches come through here and say they want to get back to playing Cardinal baseball. What does that mean to you, and what does that look like?
Well, I think Cardinal baseball is a very competitive team, and you know, you've got players that want to win and do everything they can to help us win. And I think some of the players that we've acquired, particularly the three pitchers are the prominent ones, fit that bill. There's no question that we were a little short on the pitching front last year, and I think the culture that those three and others bring is part of their asset. I mean, they're good pitchers, but also, you know, they're good teammates and competitors.
Bill, understanding the appetite for the fan base for winning baseball in St. Louis, and understanding how important it is for you guys in terms of ticket sales as part of the way you guys operate, just what was the sense of urgency from your perspective to make sure to do the things this offseason in terms of adding players and getting the team the things they needed in order to make sure this could be a quick turnaround?
Well, you know, to Mo's credit and his team's credit, when he said, you know, we're going to get three new pitchers, I thought, it's easy to say, hard to do. But he was able to do it by acting early and being aggressive. And, you know, we're fortunate that transpired because we're pretty high on that group. And, you know, it's not that easy to go out and try to fill out your starting rotation when you need three starters. So, you know, I feel good about that.
What were the conversations with Mo when you guys discussed hiring Yadi Molina as a special advisor to the team? And what do you expect from him this year to be the impact from him?
Good question. I think, you know, sort of TBD. I think anytime Yadi's around here, it's a big plus. I know Mo's talked to him on a number of occasions, and he's fired up to come here. But, you know, it's not full time. But nevertheless, I think he'll have a very strong impact when he's here, and there will be a residual effect of it as well. So I'm excited to see Yadi back here and look forward to it.
Bill, to Benjamin's earlier question, Mo's been very candid with us and certainly with you about his desire to sort of step back from his current position by the end of the 25 season. When you all bring in Chaim, the position that you brought Chaim Bloom into, is it too simplistic for us to look at that, to look at Mo's timeline and to draw a connection? Is that too simple for us, or can you imagine a future where that's how that unfolds for this team?
Well, I think, you know, Mo has said that you know, that's a potential timeline for him. And the sequence of Chaim Bloom coming on, I wouldn't say necessarily was part of that. It was, you know, get another asset in our baseball ops group. So, you know, it's a fresh look. And, you know, if it turns out that Mo is moving on or wants to go in a different direction in a couple of years, then, you know, we've got a more beefed up staff than we would have had otherwise.
Bill, you did that notably back in 2003-04 when you brought Lunhow on to have a fresh look, a different look, and kind of build up the analytics approach that then you benefited from because of Mo and Gersh and others for about another decade. And then when Mo moved up to president, one of the things he said was he wanted to address where he felt the Cardinals had fallen behind and had lost an edge. Did the industry catch up? And how do you think the Cardinals have done in the last, say, 5-6 years of kind of looking for and regaining that edge?
Well, I'm not sure when he said that.
Or he was promoted to president.
You mean?
From GM to president.
Oh, okay. Which, refresh my memory what year that was.
6 years ago, yeah.
Okay. I'm not sure that really changed his role at that point. It was more title differential. But look, you know, I think overall we've done a good job of drafting and developing. You know, we've got a good crop of young players that are emerging and have emerged, and particularly obviously on the position player side. But you can always improve and do better, and you know, it's good to get a fresh look and see if our model is continuing to be effective, and you know, we always try to improve.
Bill, when you all signed your most recent deal with Bally's, I know there was at least some discussion, some seemingly looking into what an in-house network would look like, whether it was you and the Blues or a larger conglomeration. Obviously, you didn't go that way. Are the things that you learned through that exploration process, are those still relevant now, or has the industry changed so much on that standpoint that you would maybe have to even reconsider what that process looks like if that's the way you go, whether it's in a year or 8 months or whatever it is?
Yeah, Bill's done some work on that.
Yeah, I would say that when we did our big extension with then Fox Sports Midwest, I think it was 2018, as I recall, when we signed that deal. And you know, that gave us sort of a runway of a long stretch of rights fees payments, because they're really the middleman in that situation. They buy the rights from us annually. They turn around and monetize them on their end by getting distribution and all that other stuff. So what's happened is that business model has cratered because of what we all know the trends being with cord cutting, and in some cases, even fans who have kept the bundle in their TV situations at home might have lost Cardinal baseball if, for example, their carrier, like Dish, for example, drops Fox Sports. So there's two ways in which people have run into issues getting Cardinals baseball. And so the model has gotten pressure on all fronts. Now, though, what will happen is if we get through next season under the status quo, and we're still with the Blues and the other properties on Fox Sports Midwest, it's likely that that would be the end of the line there, and that the rights would return back to us and the Blues. And so, in some respects, you're kind of a free agent at that point. You can partner with the Blues and do a channel. We could go it alone as part of perhaps a more holistic MLB-only strategy that would take care of a number of issues for fans related to access, which is a problem for us right now. In any event, regardless of how it works with Blues, without, on our own, what have you, it's likely there will be a direct-to-consumer product that emerges where anybody that doesn't have access to games now would be able to buy a monthly package and get direct streaming in market. That's in the future, whether it's next year or beyond. So I think to summarize on this issue, from a team standpoint and from an industry standpoint, it's quite a scramble. It's quite a project to figure out how to get all these teams that are getting the rights handed back to them back into a place where they were. While other teams haven't gotten to that point yet, maybe they still have an RSM that's viable for a period of time or into the future or not. The main thing to think about, though, is from a fan standpoint, it's going to get better pretty soon. The two ways in which they've lost access to Cardinal games that I mentioned before, those both go away if you have a direct-to-consumer product. So I think this is very interesting from a team point of view. And it's a lot of work for us to really understand our market better if we have to monetize our own rights and all that kind of stuff. So all that has, like, internal issues for us to deal with. But again, from a fan standpoint, I think actually things get better because of this disruption.
Is there a similarly sized market that you all have sort of modeled that might look like? Right? I think of Pittsburgh, for instance, right? They do have some ownership of their own IRS, and I believe Fenway Sports actually owns their network, and there's some of that that happens there as well. Is there, I don't know, what do you look at? Because Marquee, obviously, that's a larger market, and SNY is a larger market. And so when you look at those team-owned networks versus maybe it is as simple as you go to Cardinals.com and you pay whatever the rate is and you're accessing it. Is that sort of, I mean, is that the rub? Is that what we should be looking at in terms of how you all think about that development?
Well, look, we're looking at all the other team models. The one you mentioned in Pittsburgh, the Pirates and the Penguins just entered into an agreement to do a channel on their own. And, you know, we talk to other teams a lot. In fact, my counterparts with the other teams, particularly the Bally's teams, are very commonly communicating with each other and trying to be helpful about, have you looked at this? Are you doing your homework on that? I've talked to the Padres and the Diamondbacks, who had their rights handed back to them in the middle of the last season. I'm in close contact with MLB Media. Billy Chambers is running the entity that MLB set up to help teams handle this transition. So it's definitely like a big project. And the other piece of it is we're doing a lot more work about our actual TV market that we have. You know, when Bally's was paying us a rights fee and then turning around and distributing it into our TV market, in some respects, you kind of, you know, would focus on other things because that was a long-term agreement. They were taking care of it. Well, now if it's in our lap, like, we better know our market. We better know who's out there. We better know what ratings have looked like in outer market territories, inner market territories. We better understand how our ticket sales and other things overlay with those numbers. And that's something that could have ancillary benefits for us as we understand our market better. And maybe we package things related to TV access and tickets. And so I could kind of go on and on. But the bottom line is that we want to take this opportunity to deal with this disruption in a way that may benefit us beyond just handling our rights coming back to us in the most efficient possible way on the TV front.
Bill, do you have to be prepared to get your games going independently next season, 2025? Do you have to be prepared to be the independent provider for your games, even if there's the possibility of an MLB kind of group thing? Do you have to kind of prepare the idea that it'll be you reaching out?
Well, if you're a free agent with your rights, like we might be in 2025, there are multiple ways that could go, right? We could do our own network. We could work with MLB and have it be a MLB-led effort with a basket of MLB teams that are out in the marketplace getting distribution collectively. There could be another third party that emerges. I mean, there's been rumors of the big boys in the bankruptcy auction court, right? I mean, coming in and saying, you know, maybe we'll buy these rights, in which case you'd have an intermediary again to deal with. Instead of Bally's, maybe it's someone else. So there are multiple scenarios out there that could play out, and we need to be ready for all of them. Probably if we're ready to do it ourselves, then we're ready for anything. That's sort of my philosophy.
Is there a scenario where this levels the playing field for all teams, where, I mean, the Yankees and the Dodgers, these teams benefit from large rights fees because of their market? Is there a scenario at all where, because of this, the disruption is a good word, where it levels the playing field for all teams, and all of a sudden that's the route to, for maybe some of the smaller market teams to move up?
You want to take that one?
Yeah. You know, that's hard to say. I mean, they've got some of them on their own networks now, and they're doing well. So, you know, that may or may not change. I just think there's a lot of uncertainty. And, you know, the big markets in the end will have an advantage because they've got more subscribers and more eyeballs. But, you know, I think we've got a pretty darn good market and bigger than obviously what the city of St. Louis is, because we've got a broad fan base. And one of the disappointing things as time has gone on is we've lost subscribers. And that it's not just the money from the subscribers, but it's, you know, potential loss of ability to follow the team. So, you know, this is a big project for us.
Is MLB's goal to move towards a more level playing field through the media route? I would say yes, that is an industry goal. Is it doable and practical? That remains to be seen. But I think the disruption gives the industry an opportunity to try to move in that direction. As you know, we have revenue sharing, which is a catch-all for no matter how you get your revenue, local media, tickets, concessions, sponsorship, or what have you. If you're getting a little bit more over time, even playing field on media, then that's a positive thing. But strategically, how do you level the playing field a little bit more if you're the commissioner, which is a goal? Certainly media is the first place to look. Which is how you would implement that is multiple scenario analysis in New York. You're right, but that's actually largely a MLB asset because people in Japan who might want to stream the game on MLB TV, that would be going into the central fund piece and not directly to the Dodgers. The Dodgers will benefit from some additional sponsorship from that, but probably not directly benefit from a TV windfall of any kind.
I think it's hard to, at this point, speculate on how it's all going to play out because there are a lot of options out there. And I think from our perspective, our goal is to maximize the eyeballs on Cardinal games and, you know, continue the broader reach that we have for our fan base. And, you know, also try to maximize the value of that. But, you know, it's disappointing when we have fans who can't get our games. And I do think one of MLB's goals is to make sure all fans can get all games that they want and not be cut out of certain, you know, games that aren't available to them because of the current model.
Bill, what percentage of your average work day is this taking up, this conversation here? I mean, if you go into the office, like, how much of your day is, how do I get the game on TV?
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't put a huge percentage, but it's, like, chunky. You know, there'll be, like, a whole few days working on this with, like, an upcoming milestone, and then you'll kind of move to other. But so, yeah, but it's top of my list, that's for sure. Yeah, I would say, first of all, I'm very impressed with what they pulled off because, you know, they got the stadium and the training facility done in right there in Midtown. It was from scratch. Like, you know, I remember when we were designing this building and I thought, you know, being very involved in like the design and development process, he was the financial guru behind the scenes. how important it was for us to get feedback from all the people that have been around here a long time related to design and development and, like, how should we design the clubhouse? Well, let's talk to the clubhouse guys, bring them in on the design process. If you're starting from scratch, what do you do? I mean, I'm just very impressed that they were able to pull that off with starting the franchise from scratch and then designing a stadium without that, you know, history and organizational history. So, first of all, kudos to them for pulling it off. And then to have a winning team in the first year, make the playoffs, pretty awesome. So I think, and we've tried to be very open and accommodating to any questions they may have had. We're proud of that relationship we've had and built with the Blues. You mentioned the puck drop 8 years ago. It certainly goes well beyond that into, I would call it a special relationship with the Blues and the Cardinals, and we've tried to pull City SC into that too. So it's just a feel good for me when we see their players at our events rooting for us and vice versa. And some people in my position have took note of that a little bit and said, it's so weird you guys are like friendly with the teams in your market. And support each other because we're sort of at each other's throats, and they take the view sometimes that we're competing for the same entertainment dollar, you know, so we got to out-compete the other guys, and I don't look at it that way at all. And I don't think our fans look at it that way. So it's been a pretty cool story for St. Louis, I think.
Well, we were hopeful of getting it started this year, but it's not looking that way at the moment. So, and we're getting right down to spring training. The big key is to get it right. And, you know, I think we're on the verge of getting it right. But, you know, it's probably going to be pushed back a year. So, you know. We've been in that facility for a long time, and one more year's fine too.
Well, when you look at the on-field results last year, what gives you the most confidence that that was the one-off or the anomaly as opposed to something maybe bigger starting?
I think it was just one of those years where, you know, what could go wrong did go wrong, and you have years, what could go right did go right. Baseball's an interesting game that way. You go into a season and you think you've got a really good team and get off to the kind of start we did. It can have an effect as the year goes on. So I remember Tony La Russa, when he was managing, always said, I want to get off to a good start because it sets the tone for the rest of the year. Well, the opposite of that happened.
The ticket sales guys say the same thing.
Yeah, right. So, you know, things happen in baseball. It's not, there's no perfect science, that's for sure.
Okay, I ask you about this season. In that, you've always been very pragmatic about evaluating seasons as a whole. You know, you don't want to overreact to a month or a half. But in some ways, the way last season started and where it led,
well, the good news is we'll play some tough teams early, but then we, you know, we'll play them down the line. But, you know, how you start isn't necessarily how you finish. So, you know, obviously we're going to try to start strong and be strong the whole way. But there's so many ups and downs to a baseball season that, you know, you can have a wonderful start and, you know, before you know it, you're below 500. So it's a great game that way, very very uncertain.
Bill, with just how important ticket sales and attendance are, do you have any concern about carryover just from last season going into this year? Obviously looking at for a bounce back after a tough season years ago.
Well, you can talk to
them. Yeah, we're actually pretty happy so far with our ticket sales. We right out of the gate, we started a little slow, and then Mo made those pitching moves. I think that really bolstered interest in the team. And when you look at sort of where we are right now, it sets us up for, I think, achieving our goal of 3 million tickets sold, which is always a great milestone for us, out of reach for many clubs. There are teams that have been around for a long, long time, never gotten close to that number. So I think our fans understand that we have a team that figures to be very competitive this year. And I think it's showing in the pre-sale. We sell about 70-80% of our tickets before opening day. So the off season is very important. But that last 20-30% is a big piece of that budget that, you know, make or break. And that is a function of how we're playing and so forth. And we saw at the end of last season some no-shows and, you know, the trends that are obvious if you're not in the race. But you know, I'm pleasantly surprised about where ticket sales are to this point, but we've got a lot of work to do, obviously.
What about the other side of the
hotel? I'm just calling Bill, I think.
Is that me?
Yeah.
You talked about that last 20-30%. That's on a gross number, 3 million tickets, but there's also discounting that's involved that sometimes you need to stimulate that. If the team's playing well, you have to do less of that, therefore greater profit. In a positive scenario where things go well, you get off to a good start, is there a possibility to invest further in the team later during the season if needed to sort of push them that last step?
I think we've always had the belief that if you have some dry powder and your team is competitive, it gives you perhaps an opportunity during the trade deadline or at other points prior to improve the club. It doesn't have to be that way, but ideally optionality is nice. And then, you know, a team that or a season in which revenue is outpacing budget and projections just gives you that much more room, you know, or flexibility. So, yeah, I mean, those things can play into, you know, we don't like say, you know, okay, we've studied the numbers and this is the payroll number. I mean, of course, there's a number that sort of we start with, it bounces around a little bit based on things, but it's a little more fluid than you might think as information comes in the season related to revenue, expenses, and all that, and the team performance. Sorry.
From everybody, from you two all the way down to Bat Boys, the lowest, or what have you. No offense to the Bat Boys if you're not the lowest. But is there a sense of urgency of restoration? Is that a fair way to put it? Like, let's restore the St. Louis Cardinals thing to be winners not only in the regular season but in the postseason. Is that a fair way of describing it?
Yeah, I think, well, we're trying to put the best team that we can on the field. And our view is that, you know, if we do a good enough job, we'll be in that position. So that's obviously our goal. You know, we've always said we want to continue to have year in, year out, strong competitive teams that have a chance to, you know, get into the playoffs and do good things in the playoffs. So, you know, we're sticking to that. Hopefully we'll continue to stick to that and it'll play out.